man, his voice is so deep, y'all. He is a walking bass.
We just thank God for Brother Barr. He sings professionally as well, so we thank God for him coming on this morning. Be turning your Bibles to Philippians chapter 2, and let's commence at verse number 5, and we will go down a few verses to try to get the context of what we're going to be speaking about on this morning. Philippians chapter 2 and verse number 5. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
If you need a blessing, say bless the preacher.
Bless the preacher.
If you need God to give you a word, say speak, Lord.
For
your servant is listening. Pray for me silently on this morning. It's good to see you. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. I'm reading from the New American Standard Translation. Pray for me silently. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or disputing. Somebody need to say amen.
Amen.
So that you will prove yourselves to be blameless and innocent, children of God above reproach in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you appear as lights to the world. Look at your neighbors and neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
God's workout plan. Tell them one more time, neighbor.
Neighbor.
God's workout plan. I want you to know this morning that God has a workout plan. And we're going to talk about that on this morning. God's workout plan. For those of you who are honest, around the beginning of the year, most people make a New Year's resolution. Am I right about it? And by the time April comes, they have already abandoned their New Year's, you might as well say amen, resolution. Amen, somebody. And in the beginning of the year, you tell yourself, well, I knew I need to lose a few pounds and I'm going to start working out. So you began to try your hardest, but somewhere along by Valentine's Day, you can say amen this morning. You just abandon your workout plan. Because it becomes difficult for people to try to change their diet and try to eat healthier and begin to work out and exercise regularly, although we all should strive for that. Am I right about it? But most people sometimes just end up paying a gym membership for no reason, because they just don't go consistently here. So I want you to know that a good friend of mine, one of my fraternity brothers, gave me a quote the other day, and he said he has come to the realization that he desires Girl Scout cookies more so than abs. Amen, somebody. He just has made up his mind that Girl Scout cookies are more important than having abdominal muscles. Amen, somebody. Because working out is just difficult, it's arduous, and sometimes you may just lack motivation. And so what some people do is hire a trainer. Somebody said trainer. Yeah, they hire a trainer because on their own, they won't go to the gym. On their own, they won't eat right. So they hire a trainer and pay for a trainer to give them a workout plan. Am I right about it? Can I tell you on this morning, using that same illustration, God has a workout plan, because there are just certain things in your life that you're going to come across and you're going to have to deal with that you're going to have to work out. Somebody say work out. You're going to have to work it out. Say work it out. And so those things sometimes in life are tough, but I wanted to help you understand on this morning that God is our trainer. Amen, somebody. And God, as our trainer, he is giving us a workout plan. So we see God's workout plan in Philippians chapter 2. I have thoroughly enjoyed our Thursday evening Bible study on this, and I had hoped to be able to preach a few sermons on this before we go into our next series here. But as you know, when you read Philippians chapter 2, it's a very interesting chapter. In Philippians chapter 2, on the last time I preached this, I want you to understand that Paul is writing to the Philippian church, and he is trying to help them understand that they need not to be selfish. Amen, somebody. Somebody says selfish. Because every now and then, all of us sometimes are. You might as well say amen, somebody. And so we become selfish at times. So he said, I want you to regard other people as being more important than yourselves. Amen, somebody. And he said, I want you to put other people's interests before your own personal interests. And then he said that Jesus had this same attitude. Then he says in verse 5, have this attitude in you, which was also church in Christ Jesus. What did Jesus Christ do? He had an attitude of humility because he emptied himself. Somebody say emptied himself. What did he do, church? He emptied himself. He reduced or neutralized his status at God to come down here, take the form of a man, in the appearance of a man, wrap himself in some flesh for us, and be humiliated and died on the cross for our sins. Amen, somebody. What did Jesus do, church? He humbled himself. He allowed himself to be humiliated for who? You and I. Y'all keep smiling on this morning. You ought to be happy that Jesus did that for you and me, because without Jesus going to the cross and humbling himself to the point of death, you and I could not have the remission, amen, somebody, of your sins. Aren't you happy that Jesus went to the cross? Sometimes it makes you shout, and sometimes it makes you cry. I'm just happy that he went to the cross, amen, somebody, because had he not went to the cross, we would not have forgiveness of sin, amen, somebody. So you ought to be thankful and happy that Jesus decided to go to the cross. So Paul now writes to the Philippian church and says, have that same attitude. Have the same attitude that Jesus had in you. And he says that Jesus emptied himself, and then he took the form of a bondservant, and then Jesus was obedient. Somebody say obedient. Jesus was obedient to death. Watch this. Even death on a cross. He makes the distinguished argument that Jesus was willing to humble himself to the degree that he was willing to go where? To the cross to do what? To die for the sins of the world. So since Jesus was obedient to God, he says, have this attitude. And then he says, because he did that, now God is going to exalt him. Somebody say, exalt him. See, when you lower yourself, God will exalt you. But if you exalt yourself, then God will humble you or lower you. So Jesus lowered himself, and then God says, I'm going to give you a name better than every other name. Amen, somebody. I'm going to give you a name above every other name on the earth, in heaven, and even under the earth. That is the name of Jesus. Somebody said Jesus. And every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Every knee shall bow. Am I right about it? You might as well bow down right now. We sing a song called Bow Down. Listen, in the of singing that song, you need to make sure you really, amen, somebody, bow down to the Lord. Hitler got to bow down. Yes, Every man who ever done a sin that died away from God has to bow down. You might as well do it now. Amen, somebody. Bow down to the Lord. Bow down and consecrate yourself to Jesus. Knowing that Jesus walked this earth in the flesh, he was a man just like we are, yet without sin. Amen, somebody. Don't you love the Lord? And so what Jesus did was he humbled himself. So in verse 12, I want you to understand that Paul says, so then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but much more in my absence. In other words, Paul is telling the Philippian church, you have always been the type of church that have been obedient to God while you were in my presence. Because you remember, I don't have time this morning, but write it down. In Acts chapter 16, the Philippians were converted by the Apostle Paul. You remember Lydia down by the riverside? Amen, somebody. How Paul was speaking to her, and then she became receptive to the things that were said by Paul, and she was baptized, her and her whole household. And the Philippian jailer, somebody said jailer. You remember the one that was about to commit suicide. Instead of getting suicide, he got sanctification. Amen, somebody. So he was about to commit suicide, and Paul told him, stop, don't kill yourself, we're all right here. And then Paul began speaking the word to him. Amen, somebody. And the Philippian jailer was baptized the same hour, and his whole household. That's when the Philippian church was planted by the Apostle Paul. Why? Because they obeyed. Somebody say obeyed. So he says, just like you have always obeyed in my presence, and even much more in my absence. Now he says, I want you to understand what God's workout plan is. Notice the Bible says in verse number 12, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with what? Fear and trembling. Here it is, church. Here's what I want to say this morning. God wants you to work out your salvation. God, church, wants you and I to work out. Somebody say work out. Somebody say work out. God wants you and I to work out our salvation. Now, there are many people who, of course, indeed, church, misinterpret this verse, and they think that the verse is talking about having to work for their salvation. Let me tell you something. I don't care how good you are and how long you've been good. There's no amount of work you can do to work for. Amen, somebody. You can't work for salvation. He didn't say work for your salvation. He says work out your salvation. In other words, Paul is saying the salvation that God has already given you, you need to work it out. Somebody say work it out. So you don't work to be saved. You work because you already, amen, somebody. You work because you are saved. Amen, somebody. So he says the salvation that God has already given to you, you need to do what? Work it out. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, you need to work it out. Tell them one more time, neighbor, work it out. Now, here's what the word workout means. It means to bring to a completion. It means to accomplish. All right, here it is. From the time when you become born again and the time when you become a saved person, you have attained salvation. Somebody say attained. What have you attained? Salvation. But I want you to understand that not only does salvation have to be attained, salvation has to be maintained. Somebody say maintained. Y'all keep smiling on this morning. Salvation has to be attained, and salvation has to be what? Well, how do you maintain? You work it out. Amen, somebody. Your salvation has to be worked out. Now, here's what that means. From the beginning, when you become to be a saved person in right relationship with God, you will go through some stuff in your life, watch it, that will challenge your obedience. Am I right about it? You will go through some time, some places, with some issues and some predicaments in your life that will challenge your obedience. Now, I want you to understand the context. He just told you in the adjoining verses, in that whole pericope, that Jesus humbled himself to be obedient to the point of what? So Jesus was willing to die so that he could maintain being obedient to who? To God. God. So he's telling us, just like you have always obeyed, you need to make sure you work out your salvation by making sure that you maintain your obedience throughout the whole course of your life, even unto death. That's what working out your salvation is all about, because there's going to be some times when you and I are challenged, church. You're going to be challenged to want to go off on somebody else. Y'all won't help me in here this morning. Just like they went off on you. Am I right about it? And the old you wants to come back out every now and then, Brother Bar. Am I right about it? So what you're going to have to do is, when somebody has an attitude with you, guess what you got to do? You got to work it out. You got to work it out. So in other words, while you are saved, you have to humble yourself to be obedient in every aspect of your life. And when you do that, you are working out your salvation. Amen, somebody. Because when you are challenged on Monday for those who have to go to work. Amen, somebody. Anybody ever wake up and go to work on Monday? And sometimes Monday are the toughest days to go to work. Am I right about it? You wish you had a 3-day weekend when you only had a 2-day weekend, and everything you thought you was going to accomplish, you ain't getting none of that stuff done. And the moment you walk up in work, somebody got an attitude. Yeah. Y'all won't help me in here this morning. Am I right about it? But what do you got to do? When they have an attitude with you, you got to work it out. You have to still be obedient to God no matter what you go through in your life. And when you do that, you're working it out. You got to work out your soul's salvation. Now, here's what the attitude that Paul says, work out your salvation. He says, with fear and trembling. Let's say it together. With fear and with
fear
and
trembling.
And this side over here, they got it. And this side over here, they got it.
With fear
and trembling. Okay, y'all got it. With
fear
and so how do you work out your salvation? With
fear
and trembling. Now what does that mean? That means as you humble yourself as a saved person throughout the course of your life, my attitude as I work out my salvation is with
fear
and trembling. In other words, here it is. Even though my mind or my carnality tells me to act a fool, I ain't gonna do it because I'm working out my salvation with
fear.
And in other words, you have to be fearful of God. Part of our issue that in today's society, church, is that people don't have the fear of God like they used to when I was coming up. Amen, somebody. You had to fear your parents. Amen, somebody. And they didn't have no timeout when I was growing up. The only timeout you had if you played a basketball game and your coach called it. Your parents ain't never gonna call no timeout. They gonna whoop you. Amen, somebody. Yeah, we was used to belts and getting spankings, and in Abbeville and Greenwood, we call them whoopings. Am I right about it, Brother Waller? Amen, somebody. And you knew that was your discipline for not obeying your authority, which was your parents. Amen, somebody. So you had the fear of your parents. My daddy would just look over at the couch, because he used to keep the belt over on the couch. Amen, somebody. He didn't have to chase me around the house or go to his coat hanger and try to get a belt. He kept the belt on the couch. And he would just look over there and say, listen, you boy, you got one more time. What are you doing? I'm putting the fear in my son. Amen, somebody. And I knew if he said that, it was going down. Amen, somebody. So you have to understand that God is our Father. And we need to be fearful that if we disobey God, God gonna get us. So regardless of how people treat us, if we are going to work out our salvation and accomplish it from the beginning and hold on to it to the end, we need to make sure we work it out by being obedient no matter what happens with
fear.
And so here it is in the Old Testament. There are places in the Old Testament when if you disobeyed God. I remember one time in Numbers 16, just writing this down, go home and read it. In Numbers 16, there were some people where God didn't even wait on a judgment. God just opened up the ground and they just went under in 250 people and he closed it. You got to fear God. I just did a series on the audacity of faith, and we talked about Joshua, that there was a man by the name of Achan. And Achan took some of the accursed things, the things that were under the ban, and he was stoned to death. Are y'all in here on this morning? I said he was stoned to death, him and his family, because he disobeyed God's commandments. So that word fear is where we get it, comes from a Greek term, phobos, is where we get our English word phobia. We need to have a fear of God. In other words, I don't want to do nothing wrong. I want to be obedient unto God, and I have the fear of God in me. That's why I'm obedient to God. Amen. So you got to have God in your God consciousness. Because the preacher can't always be with you. The church can't always be with you. Your husband and your wife can't always be with you. You're going to be by yourself, and Satan is going to be working on your mind and trying to use his demonic influence in your life to get you to disobey God. But when you have fear and you say, I don't care if no human being is watching me. I know God is watching me. And if I got to go through something in my marriage, I'm going to work it out. Amen, somebody. If I got to go through something on my job, I'm going to. If I got to go through something with my children, I'm going to. Whatever I got to go through with my finances, I'm going to. If the doctors have given me a bit of bad news, I'm going to. You got to work it out. But see, going through something in your life does not give you a free pass to be disobedient to God. Let me say it one more time. Just because you go through something in your life does not give you the authority or the right or a free pass to disobey God. Because if you do not work out your salvation with fear and trembling, you may lose your salvation. Amen, somebody. Because you could fall into the practice of sin. Just don't have time this morning, but Galatians chapter 5, make sure you go home and make that your homework assignment, because you got to make sure that you don't fall into the practice of sin. Because if you fall into the practice of sin, you can lose your soul and go to hell. I said hell, because hell is in the Bible, and hell is a real place. So we got to make sure we work out our salvation with what?
Fear.
Now, what does that mean to you? If your health and your finances are funny, I'm still going to work it out. Because I want to obey God. I want to be right with the Lord. So Paul is telling the Philippian church, whatever you do, just make sure, just like Jesus gave you that example, your attitude needs to be an attitude with fear and trembling, and I'm going to work out my salvation. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Now, I want you to understand something, Brother Robinson. I want you to read Philippians chapter 2. And let's look at verse number 13. What does the Bible say? Verse number 12, I'm sorry. What does the Bible say?
So then, my beloved.
Yeah.
Just as you have always obeyed.
Just as you have always obeyed. Yeah.
Not as in my presence only.
Yeah.
But now much more in my absence.
All right.
Work out your salvation.
With what?
With fear and trembling.
Go ahead and read.
For it is God who is at work in you.
Now watch this. For it is
God.
Who? God who is doing what?
At work in you.
God is at work in you. God is the one that's propelling you to, who is operating your spiritual forces in your life. That's what that word work here means. It means operating his spiritual force in your life, because God is at work in you. Whatever it is that you do that's good, it ain't because you so good. Y'all keep smiling on this morning. It ain't because you so righteous. It means that God is what? At work in you. So anytime you cannot curse somebody out when they curse you out, Don't think because you're so good. It's because God is doing what? He is at work in you. Because it's an awesome feeling, Brother Robinson, to know that God is at work in me on my job. God is at work with me while I'm at church. God is at work in you while you're helping out the homeless. God is at work in you when you're helping children. God is at work in you when you're helping out people who have a need. Amen, somebody. So anytime you are living your life and living in this life, God will place challenges in your life, but you got to work it out.
Yes, sir.
And just know that it's God that's at work in you for his what? For his will, and what else?
And to work his good pleasure.
So God uses us to work out for his will and his good pleasure. So the work that we do as we work out our salvation is to please God, and it's according to God's what?
Will.
Now let me give you something. Pray for your enemies. We saying amen. Yeah, we saying amen because we know that's the truth. That's what we got to do. But the question is, do we pray for our enemies or do we pray for their demise? Y'all ain't even saying nothing this morning. Y'all all right? Because what we need to make sure that God is at work in us. We have to be different. We have to be humble. Jesus was obedient even to the point of death on the cross. So whatever it is that we got to go through, we got to work it out and know that God is at work in us for his will and his good pleasure. Is that all right this morning? Because it's a beautiful thing to know that everybody else is against you, but God is for you. And I'm gonna keep on walking and I'm gonna keep on working. I'm gonna walk with the Lord and I'm gonna work with the Lord. Amen, somebody. I'm gonna walk with the Lord and I'm gonna work. Well, Brother Jones, they lying on me. Let me tell you something. Folk lie. Amen. And you can't not come to church because somebody at church lied on you. Let me tell you. People will lie on you regardless of your well intent, regardless of the fact that you have demonstrated proven spiritual integrity, regardless of your status, of your rank, or whatever your prominence. Folk will lie on you. And they lied on Jesus. Amen, somebody. And they told lies on the Messianic Master. And Jesus said in the Gospel according to John that you are your father, Satan, because he is a father of lies. Amen, somebody. So Satan gets in people and causes people to lie on good folk. Folk who ain't done nothing wrong. But there are liars out there that are trying to have your demise, have your fall, and they are trying to destroy your reputation. And you can't fall out with folk in the church when they lie on you, because they did the same thing to Jesus. So if you're going to work that thing out, what you must do is pray for them. You can't stop nobody from lying on you. But here's what you can do. You can demonstrate spiritual behavior while they attack you. And in my spiritual behavior, I'm going to work it out with fear. Amen, somebody. And trembling. I'm not going to go and talk about them because they talked about me. Because I know God is watching me and he wants me to work this thing out with fear. And yeah, so I'm afraid to disobey God. I'm afraid to go back off on somebody. I'm afraid not to be spiritual. I'm afraid not to do the right thing, regardless of how they treat me and regardless of what they say to me. Amen. Amen, somebody. We got to elevate our spirituality to that degree and mature as children of God so we can work it out. Amen. And you need me to tell you something. When you work it out and nobody else is looking and nobody else is watching, but God. Somebody say, but God. Somebody say, but God. You can walk around with your shoulders squared, Sister Lee, because I ain't worried about them. God approves of my behavior. God know I'm trying to work it out. God know I'm working it out with fear. And so I know God. I'm all right with God. And God can handle them. Amen, somebody. God can handle folks who lie on you. But I want to prove this point because some of us are going through things. Amen, somebody. Amen. Folk lying on you, folk cheating on you, folk just treating you any type of way, and people talking about you, and it's hurtful. Am I right about it? Amen. It's hurtful, but you got to understand they did the same thing for Jesus. So you work it out when you pray for them, and you behave in the spiritual way. I love what Michelle Obama said, Sister Lee. She said, when they go low, we go high. Amen, somebody. We have to have eagle mentality. You know one thing I love about eagles? Eagles fly high. As a matter of fact, eagles fly so high, they fly at a level where some other stuff would die at. So you know that's telling us? If you want to kill some folk in your life, y'all ain't saying nothing this morning. Fly high!
as an eagle. Amen, somebody. They can't get your way up there. You too high. Yeah, you too high for them. Yeah, and so you don't let this stuff bother you. Amen, somebody. So you got to work it out with fear and trembling, and to do it for God's will and for God's good pleasure. And the reason why we don't work it out is right here in verse number 14. Verse number 14, Brother Robinson, the Bible says what?
Do all things.
Do all things.
Without grumbling or disputing.
Without what?
Without grumbling or disputing.
Did he say do some things?
All things.
Every now and then things?
All things.
Whenever I feel like it things?
All things.
He says do all things with what?
Without grumbling or disputing.
Now, the text says do all things without what?
Grumbling or disputing.
All right. We got some folks to do everything with. Y'all ain't saying nothing this morning. I'm going to preach the truth anyway. Y'all been around some folks that just can't nothing be right. Everything they want to complain about. They want to talk about everybody. Lord have mercy. Paul says, if you're going to be unselfish and work out your soul salvation, he says, not do some things, but not do some things when you get ready. He says, do all things without what?
Grumbling or disputing.
The reason why it's tough for people to live right and it's tough for people to work out their salvation is because some of us surround ourselves with negative, pessimistic people who speak negative words of discouragement instead of positive words of encouragement. Am I right about it? So I want you to understand that if you surround yourself with the most unspiritual people, the folks who talking about everybody in the church and talking about you as soon as you turn your back, amen, somebody, you are going to be affected by what they say out of your mouth. And when they say, I'm not going to church, guess what you're going to say? Well, since they ain't going. Because last time we supposed to have a fish and we had chicken, so I ain't going today. And such didn't speak to me. Can you believe the audacity of sister such and such or brother such and such? And they didn't even speak to me today. So I'm not going today. Were you going? And you said, well, I guess I ain't going either then. Because see. That's why Paul says, do all things without. Do you not know that when you are around negative people who are complaining and grumbling, it will cause you not to be obedient? You can have good intentions, but it will cause you not to obey the Lord because you're surrounding yourself with somebody who's grumbling and murmuring and complaining. They're grumbling. They're murmuring. And y'all ain't got it yet. And they complaining. They're grumbling. Come on, open your mouth. And they're murmuring and they're complaining. What are they doing? They grumbling and they're murmuring and they're. Now, that's so difficult for leaders. Because I was telling somebody this morning, sometimes I have my Moses moments. Amen, somebody. You know, Moses had some moments where he was trying to lead God's people and it began to be arduous and tough and taxing on his mind and taxing on his spirit. So sometimes I have my Moses moments too. Amen, somebody. But Moses was in a position where he was told to obey God's instructions. This is right here in Numbers chapter 20. When you go home, I want you to read that too. You got a few homework assignments this morning. Amen. So Numbers chapter 20. And God told Moses, the people of God were complaining. The congregation needed some water because their beasts and their animals had not had anything to drink because it was dry and they didn't have no water. Now you and I have always had water. If we did not have it, we know we can go to the store and get a bottle of water. We know we can go to the spigot. And we used to say in the country, amen, anybody used to say spigot in here? Country folk in here, ain't everybody city? Okay. And where I'm from, we said spigot, and you go to that spigot and you get that water, and you can go to the water. We have always had access to water, but this congregation had no access to water. And brothers, could you imagine your wife dehydrated and your children dehydrated and you have nowhere to get water? You don't know how you, because you're in the desert. And they had a legitimate complaint and they began murmuring and they began complaining and they began telling Moses, we should have just stayed in Egypt because we are here to die. And I don't know why God allowed us to be out here. So they were arguing, they were grumbling, they were murmuring and they were complaining. Amen, somebody. Amen. So Moses went to God with the thing that he should have done. And he told God what was going on, and the people were complaining, and God told him what to do. He said, I want you to take your brother Aaron, and I want you to get that rock, but he said, I want you to speak to the rock. Somebody say, speak to the rock. He didn't say, I want you to strike the rock. He said, I want you to speak. And he gave him specific instructions.
But because the people had complained so much, and the people had grumbled, and they had murmured, and they had got on Moses' last, they had got up under, and he was ready to go off. Moses said, listen, you rebels, shall we bring forth water out of this rock for you? And Moses got his Louisville slugger.
And he said, I'm going to strike this thing.
And Moses struck the rock, and water came out the rock. Here's a pertinent preaching moment that's pregnant with powerful information for you leaders out here. Even though the leader could disobey, God won't penalize the congregation, because the water still came out. But God told Moses, I told you to speak to the rock, but you struck the rock. And I'm not going to penalize my people because it was your fault. But what I'm going to do to you is you are not going to be able to enter into the promised land because you did not treat me holy among this assembly.
Amen.
So the people's complaints caused Moses to act a fool. And because Moses disobeyed God, now Moses can't enter into the promised land. What are you saying? When you listen to folk complaining, when you listen to murmuring and all of that stuff, it will distract you and get your mind off of obeying God. That's why Paul says in Philippians chapter number 2 and verse number 14, the Bible says what?
Do all things.
Do all things.
Without grumbling or disputing.
That's why he said, whatever you do, do it without grumbling or disputing. Because I had just told you to work it out. And you, in order to work it out, you got to obey God. But if folk are complaining, you're not going to be able to obey God. Amen, somebody. Are y'all following that on this morning? Because it's so important for us to make sure we understand God's workout plan. God wants us to make sure that we work out our salvation. Well, how do you do it? You develop an attitude of obedience. Somebody say obedience. You have to do it with what? And you got to make sure that you disregard any negativity that will block your blessings and stop you from obeying God. Is that all right on this morning? So if you're going to work out your soul salvation, have you made up your mind, truly made up your mind, that whatever I got to go through, I'm going to obey God? Or have you said, well, you know, God, I'm going to need a pass on this one? Y'all ain't saying nothing this morning. Have you ever said, well, you know, I just ain't there yet. I just need some more teaching. No. No, God ain't through. We quick to say that God's still working on me, right? Yeah, he working on you, but he wants you to work out some stuff for yourself. Amen, somebody. That's why he said work out your salvation with what? Fear. So my question to you is, do you fear the Lord? Because if you fear the Lord, you will stop that bad behavior. If you truly knew that if you maintain your current level of behavior, you would end up in hell. Okay, here it is. Have you ever processed what it'd be like if you went to hell? Have you ever processed that in your mind? Like, took some time and thought about, for the folk who go to hell, these are the folks who were disobedient to God. These were the folks when the preacher was preaching the word of God and telling people what the Bible says they must do. These were the folks that sat down and was happy about coming to church, but cared nothing about obeying God's instructions. See, that's why I'm so happy that God has given us a spirit here at Graceview where we not only preach the word of God, we give you practical biblical applications to help you apply God's word. Because if you don't apply God's word, then you're not obeying God. And if you are disobedient to God and you practice disobedience, then you are on your way to hell. So every now and then, even for you saved folks who live in right, you need to process in your mind what going to hell would be like. And when you realize that it's going to be dark, but you're going to be burning, and the fire never stops, and there is no expiration date on hell, and that everybody lives forever, the only problem is you have to recognize whether or not you're going to live in heaven or hell, and you will be with the worst people that ever lived since the beginning of time. You would be with all those people. Somebody can come up and just hit you with anything or do anything to you. And one of the worst things I think about hell is that anybody who goes, Lord have mercy, would be away from the presence of God. Doesn't matter how big your church is, as long as your church is right. Amen, somebody. So you ought to process hell, because I want you to know that if you or I ever develop the practice of sin, that's what we on the road to. And I'm not going to let that happen in this congregation if I can help it, if you're willing to obey, because I'm going to love you and give you God's instructions and use his word to correct whatever it is in your life that you need help with so you can go. Amen, somebody. Amen. We want you to go to heaven. Amen, somebody. Somebody say heaven. Amen. Didn't we just sing a song, Heaven's on the Other Side? And listen. How in the world do people get ready to go on vacation, Brother Walla, and they pack 2 and 3 big old bags. Got your Louis Vuitton bags out at the airport. Come on in here, church. You got your nice luggage. Amen, somebody. You're looking good and you got a whole list of stuff you wanted to take on your trip to Hawaii. Amen. And if you got an extra ticket, me and Sister Jones would love to kind of tag along with you. Is that all right? Yeah. And I want you to understand that we know how to prepare for everything else. And God has given us a great big book called the Bible. And it has the instructions and the roadmap to get to heaven. Why won't you follow that and prepare for that? Because heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. Newsflash, here it is. Here's what some preachers don't tell you. Hell is too. It's a prepared place for prepared people. And those people have prepared themselves by being disobedient to God. So I want to encourage you with that so that you will then have the fear of God in you, the trembling that if God come down on me, if the hand of God come down on me in the wrong way, man, I'm in trouble. That's why I wanted to help you process hell so that you can develop that fear for not going, not wanting to go. Amen, somebody. And that you will work out your soul, your salvation with fear and trembling, and to give God's glory and to work out for God's will. Amen, somebody. So what things, as I close, what things in your life you have not yet eclipsed because you have decided that you are not at the place or you are not at the level where you can be obedient to God in those areas? You need to take all those areas right now and make up your mind. I'm going to repent. And in this particular area where I have not worked out my salvation, I'm going to work it out. Somebody say work it out. And whatever area you have not practiced obedience, in that area you're going to decide to do what? Work it out. And if you have had a bad attitude with your manager, a bad attitude with your wife, a bad attitude with your husband, a bad attitude with your children, you're going to repent and make up your mind that I'm going to. You may have not been at church the way you know you should be. Amen, somebody. And you are everywhere else instead of the place where you need to be. You have to make up your mind that you're going to repent and do what? Work it out. What is it in your life you need to work it out? God has given you an opportunity right now while you still are on the time side of life. Amen, somebody. If you are on the time side of life, you have an opportunity to do what? Work it out. See, God wants to give you salvation. Here's how God gives you salvation. God gives you salvation when you believe with all your heart that Jesus Christ is indeed the resurrected Savior. Believe that he died on the cross, and believe that he was buried in Joseph's new tomb, and believe that Jesus got up on the third day with all power in his hands. Isn't that an awesome message? Isn't that an awesome message that Jesus hung, bled, and died for you and me while we were at the club? While we were in the bed with God knows who, doing God knows what.
in God knows what place. Christ died for the ungodly. Christ died for the fornicators. Christ died for the adulterers. Christ died for the homosexuals. Christ died for the effeminate. Christ died for all of the blasphemers. Christ died for everybody.
So if you appreciate, church, if you appreciate what Christ did, like I appreciate what Christ did, I made up my mind I'm going to be obedient unto God. Let me tell you something, the best feeling that you could ever have, watch this, it's better than money. Somebody said better than money. When you know you are right with God. Y'all smile on this morning, church. Listen, when you know. Well, you are all right with God. It don't matter. Listen. If your bills get stacked sky high, well, it may be a problem. But guess what? I'm still going to heaven. Amen, somebody. No matter what happens in my life, I'm still going to heaven because I'm working it out. Amen, somebody. And Jesus died, so you can do that. So you got to believe that with all your heart. Believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Be willing to repent of your sins. Change your mind. Realize you're not working it like you need to. Then be willing to confess Christ. You know, the Bible says in Philippians 2 that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Now, if you are a sinner and not a child of God, you can confess Christ right now. Amen, somebody. You can confess Christ today and leave here a born again child of God once you obey God in the watery grave of baptism. Because the Bible says, Peter says, you have to repent in Acts 2:38. Peter replied to them, repent and be baptized, not some of you, but every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift. Somebody say Holy Ghost. Notice what Acts 2 says, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. When do you get it? When you obey the instructions and be baptized. Somebody say, be baptized. Now watch this. Somebody say Holy Ghost. Now, the Holy Ghost is God. Yeah. Amen, church. Yeah. God will indwell in you.
That's right.
And the Holy Ghost is in you when you obey God and you get baptized for remission of sin.
Amen.
The problem is that when we struggle with working out our salvation, the devil tells us to do one thing, and the Holy Spirit of God tells us to do another. We sometimes quench the Spirit and don't allow the Holy Spirit in us to be manifested in our lives. So when we know the Bible says don't fornicate, you put your key in the car. So I'll be over there in about 30 minutes. Y'all ain't got to say nothing this morning. I got this. Have you ever made a mistake and some told you, don't go nowhere, stay at home tonight. Come on, church. And you know what? And your flesh was just calling. Yeah. And the Spirit of God, through your understanding of the word, reminded you that on the pages of inspiration, the Bible says, don't do it. Somebody said, don't do it. But you ignored the Holy Spirit in you. You did not allow it to be manifest. Amen, somebody. And you listen to the flesh. And when you listen to the flesh, you will make a mistake. So God says, I'm going to give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. What is the Holy Spirit going to do? It's going to keep you. It's going to remind you. It's going to help you see what's in my word. And it's going to remind you of that. So when you're trying to work out your salvation, you got the gift of the Holy Ghost. Amen, somebody. But you only get that when you become obedient to God. So if you're here today, we have the best message in town. Church, we got the best message in Anderson.
Yes, sir.
Regardless of church size, we got the best message. We got the gospel. Amen, somebody. And the gospel will save you. The gospel will keep you. The gospel will preserve you. And as you work out your salvation, if you make it to the end, God has promised to give you a crown of life. Anybody in here want to get a crown of life, even unto death? Amen, somebody. So here it is. You do that today by walking forth. Give me your hand and give the Lord your heart. And if you're a child of God, as we stand together and sing, if you're a child of God, you know you need to repent and work it out. Come and do it right now as we stand together and sing a song of invitation.
279. Pass me not, oh gentle Savior.
You don't want Jesus to pass the church.
Oh, hear my humble cry.
How about it, church?
On others thou art calling. Oh, do not pass me by. And I'm calling you, Savior. Oh,
he's a mighty good.
I want you to hear my humble cry. Little while on earth is thou art called.
If you need prayer, we'll pray for this morning. God wants you to work it out, church.
Oh, do not pass me by.